Hello friends, in this video lecture, we will try to understand a basic part of encoder and decoder in the MPEG used known as H.261. So basically, what it means by H.261, it is an encoder and decoder type. That means it will do the process of encoding as well as decoding of a data. But what kind of data? The data which can transmit it electronically. Here, the basic thing behind the development of H.261 encoder is nothing but for the digital encoding it is used. So digital encoding means what? Or the data can be sent with the help of electronic transmission means what? We all are familiar with two types of calling. One is video calling, you can say via WhatsApp, and second one is conference calling. So while doing video call or conference call, the basic thing behind these two types of applications are nothing but the data should get transmitted electronically. That means over ISDN lines. So we are familiar with this term. Telephony system contains such kind of architecture or structure which is used for the purpose of transmission. Transmission of signals. We all know that the signals can be the audio signal and they can be the signals, the digital signals. Now, when the signals are audio signals, that will transmit some data in the form of waves, and every sampled value is able to give us some output. In the digital signal, they will give us the data in the form of binary numbers, that means 0 or 1. Indirectly, in your particular wave, the data will be present, that is one indication of 1, or the data will be absent, that means indication of 0. But it does not happen while the analog signal transmission, because there may be the presence of fractions of a data. That means what? Some point of the data can be present there, not 0 exactly, not 1, but it may be the 0.7. This is the simple example. So while doing such kind of video call or the conference call, it requires a huge amount of data, but it should get transmitted very correctly or accurately over the transmission lines. So for that purpose, basically H.261 was designed with the help of MPEG. So we are in the MPEG. MPEG means Motion Picture Expert Group, and here we try to study the standards of the MPEG and their application. So the application of MPEG-4 especially is nothing but providing us the communication over electronic transmission. And to fulfill that particular application, they have designed an encoder, because we all know that whenever we require to transmit a data, we require to encode it as well as we require to compress it. That means encoding the data and compressing the data will play an important role in a transmission purpose. So for these two terms, basically they have designed H.261 to meet all the specification requirements. Now, exactly who tried to design this? H.261 is an ITU-T video compression standard developed in November 1988. It is the first member of H.26 family of video calling standard. So itself, there are multiple standards of H.260. H.260 was originally designed for what purpose? For video calling purpose. And then there are multiple versions of that. And the first version is 26.1. So it is known as 261. After that, we may study 262, 264, like that. In your syllabus, they have strictly give the idea regarding the H.261. But after this also, the H.264, that means H.26 is the first version. or the basic version, and then developed version 4 is much more useful to encode the data, to compress the data, and to transmit the data. But we have to focus first on H.26.1. So this is the first member of H.26 family of video calling standard in the domain of the ITUT video calling expert group. H.26.1 was originally designed for the transmission over ISDN lines on which the data rates are multiple of 64K bits per second. So here we can understand that multiple of, that means minimum at least 64K bits per second, such kind of huge data rate that will provide, but it can be greater than that of that 64K bits per second, and what may be the possibility of getting the data rate, it will be multiple of the original value. So huge data rate we can achieve with the help of such kind of encoding and decoding technique. The coding algorithm was designed to able to operate at a video bit rate between 40K bits per second to 2 megabits per second, so that such kind of maximum capacity, that means such kind of huge data, we can transmit electronically over the ISDN lines, and hence there is no any limit for the video calling. That means once you are having internet in your hand, you can continue with your video call or video conference. So such kind of facilities can be provided with the help of H.261 or 26.1 encoder. Now, basically, what it will do? H.261 standard actually only specifies how to decode the video. The main purpose of the development of H.261 is the decoding part. Encoder designers were left free to design their own encoding algorithm. Now, we all are familiar with this straight step. That is nothing but input. Input gets encoded with the help of any algorithm, and then the data get decoded. So this is nothing but what? Simply to achieve the output. So after the decoding part, the output which we are getting, that should be exactly same as that of the input. This is the main purpose behind the compression term and behind the decoding and encoding algorithm. So here we are able to achieve the decrement in the size of the data, and after decoding it, we require the exact equals data what we try to send, so that if input is nothing but 1101 and your output should be 1101, then only the communication can be clear and can be having the maximum efficiency. Any one symbol, if it will be unmatched or if it will be lost during the transmission, the meaning of input and meaning of output will be changed. And hence, here for the purpose of decoding the output, the H.261 was developed. Encoder designers were left free to design with their own encoding algorithm. They are left free to perform any pre-processing they want to their input video, and decoders are allowed to perform any post-processing they want to their decoded video prior to display. That means here, whatever algorithm the encoding technique wants to use, they are left free to use. But similarly, to decode the encoded output, whatever techniques H.261 wants to use, they are also free to use. One effective post-processing technique is deblocking the filtering. So this is one of the most popular technique which can be used by this particular encoder. This reduces the appearance of block-shaped artifacts caused by the block-based motion compression and spatial information parts of the design. Now what it will do? It will try to appear a block-shaped artifacts and block-based motion compensation. That means here individual block is get compressed so that you are getting the maximum efficiency at the output. So instead of doing the compression at the same time with the help of same technique on a whole image, what it will do, it will try to use the same technique for individual block, and then it will try to develop or design the decoded output. So this is the basic theory behind the H.261. Why it will operate to do encoding and decoding. Especially it is only specified for the decoding of the data. Encoding can be do independently. And how that will do? Block shift motion compensation technique that will use. The images supplied to input to an H.261 compressor must meet both color space and size requirement. Now what it means by color space? We are familiar with these three terms, Y, CB, CR. What is Y? It is nothing but luminance. What it means by CB or CR? That are nothing but chrominance. So luminance is able to provide us brightness to our image. And chrominance contains two types of signal, C1 and C2. And specially, they are also fixed in the most application and nothing but CB and CR. Now, what it means by CB? That is nothing but blueness in image, color image. And what it means by CR? That is nothing but redness. Same in color image. So Y plus CB plus CR is able to give you the output or the exact image. So this is nothing but color space. And what it means by size? Size of a block or the image is nothing but the term matrix. Height and width of the matrix. So it can be, most probably it can be 16 by 16, especially in H.261. How much size of matrix we are getting? 16 by 16. Here again, this matrix we require to convert into Y, CB, CR specification. So the four blocks or the four matrices having 8 by 8 structure, they are contains the luminance part, while only one block of 8 by 8 matrix, they contains chrominance part, that is CB and CR. So in this way, the combination of Y plus CB plus CR is going to develop and matrix. So for development of this exact matrix, we require the proportionality in between CB, CR and Y. So here they have specified that the compressor input image must meet both color space and size requirement. So what is width and height? These are nothing but the height and width element which will specify the matrix. And in every matrix, there are some blocks. So how many blocks are there? 16 into 16. And every block contains pixel, which will try to give us idea about the value contains in the image. In terms of color space, the images must be Y, CB, CR image. That means the images must contains luminance as well as chrominance part. The term of size, the images must adhere to either the common interface format. This is known as what? CIF. So there are two types of format which we can develop or design in H.261. One is CIF, which is having the width and the height 352 into 288. That means what? The matrix parameters are fixed. Blocks in the matrix are fixed. So how much blocks can be there? 352 into 288. Or the quarter CIF. Here, the matrix size is get reduced. So the height and the width parameter will be 176 and 144. So that here, how much number of blocks will be there? 176 into 144. So in this way, it is in our hand that which kind of size of the image we will provide as an input to H.261. So the if image is too large, then we can provide the size of CIF. If it is small, we can provide the size of quarter CIF. So there are 16 cross 16 samples are present for the numinance component and 8 cross 8 samples are present for chrominance component. This for each macro ball, that is encodes. The H.261 encoder can perform the intra-frame and inter-frame compression. Now, here once we are able to design the samples or the macro balls, then what we have to do, we require to encode the data. The given data can be encoded using two types of frame structure. The one is intra-frame, which can be represented with the help of notation I, and one is inter-frame, which can be represented with the help of the notation P. So intra-frame are nothing but the frames which are very similar to JPEG. Why we try to compare that with JPEG? Because JPEG is also joint photographic expert group. This technique is used for image compression. And H.261, which we try to study, that comes under MPEG, that is motion picture expert group. And here also we try to compress the image. But what kind of image is there? The sequence of the images. And hence, to that sequence of the images, we try to call it as video. So the video compression is nothing but again what? The compression in the continuous images or the motion images. And hence there are some techniques which are very similar to that of the image compression. So whenever we require to use such kind of technology, then we will try to use intra-frames. That means the similar technique we have to apply. And whenever we try to encode the motion part which is not present in the JPEG, so obviously the compression of the still image, that means the fixed image, is nothing but the JPEG compression. And compression of the motion of the sequence of the image is nothing but what? MPEG compression. So whenever that particular technique differs from that of JPEG, then that frame comes under inter-frame compression. So there are two types of framing structures. So such kind of two types of frames we can use for the H.261. Encoding and decoding part. So we will try to understand with the help of block diagram, same theory but along with the illustration in the form of the diagram. So here what it means by intra-frame coding, I already told you that is nothing but the coding part which is very similar to that of the JPEG. So why? That means a block which is developed with the help of luminance component, CBCR, the block which is developed with the help of chrominance component. So this is nothing but what? This is nothing but our input. This is Y plus CB plus CR will form an image. So for each macro balls, now how can you convert it into the matrix? So the four matrix we required to use for representation of luminance, and 1-1 matrix we will try to use for representation of CB and CR respectively. So after the sampling of the macro ball, we required to do some operation on these 8x8 blocks. So all are having the same size of 8x8. So what kind of operation we can perform on them? DCT, discrete cosine transform, quantization, rounding up the values, and entropy coding, which is very much useful for the calculation of efficiency, that means the output. And after that, we are able to achieve some output. So such kind of architecture we can develop or design which is very same as that of the JPEG compression. Why? Because here the input we try to provide or the coding we try to do on the intra-frame. So the name of this particular diagram is nothing but what? Intra-frame coding. And after this we can go for the inter-frame coding. That means what? The part which is somewhere different than that of the JPEG. So this is nothing but the similar part of JPEG, and now we will go for the interframe coding. So two types of coding are present in the H.261. So what I try to draw in the block diagram is nothing but this. The intraframe mode, the compressor encodes the actual YCBCR values in the macro balls, and yes, it is true. It is required to apply the motion prediction at every macro ball level. Here, the predictive coding is applicable only that part of image where motion is present, and this is somewhere completely different than that of JPEG. After that, the DCT, it requires to remove high frequency components. So we are going to use DCT. So on which particular values we will try to apply DCT? We have just seen on the 8x8 data blocks. After that, quantization. Apply this process on the frequency domain coefficient. And why to apply this? This is the actual process of the compression where we are able to achieve the rounding up the values. These play an important role to store the minimum data in video. Why? Because compression is takes place, the actual reduction in the size of the data is takes place in this particular process. And hence, once that will do, or once that will complete, then what we can do? We can store the minimum data in a video. The previous data was X, suppose. After the quantization, obviously, the actual reduction in the data size takes place, and that will be X minus N. So suppose here I am required D1 data space to store this particular X amount of value, then here I will surely require D1 minus N space to store X minus N size. So this wrote that the minimum data in video we can store. So this is actually the advantage of the compression. So what kind of operation we required to perform? The first one is entropy encoding. Second one is convert the 2D symbol into 1D. Third one is apply zigzag pattern on the coefficient. Fourth one is apply or use RLE for one dimensional pattern. And last one is apply Huffman coding. Now we will see this one by one. Before observing or before explaining the steps for calculation of entropy, I want to explain you the steps which are essential for H.261, that is 26.1 algorithm. How can we classify them? The first step is prediction, second one is block transformation, and third one is nothing but the quantization and entropy. The first one is prediction. So this is somewhere different than that of the JPEG. Block transformation we have just studied. That is YCBCR. So this is Y, this is CB, this is CR. And all the matrix having the same size. 8 cross 8. 8 cross 8. And here how many matrices are present? Total 4 matrices are present having the size of 8 cross 8. So this is nothing but the block transformation. But how can we do the block transformation? The steps from this to this, that means second and third step, is same as that of the JPEG, but still the output is different. So where we can do that particular error, or where we can count that particular error or difference between MPEG and JPEG in the first step, that is known as the prediction. So how can we predict any sample? Suppose in the first macro ball, this is nothing but the reference macro ball. (16x16) matrices, and here somewhere the motion is occurred. after the motion vector, that is, this is nothing but the past sample, after the motion that will go from this particular block to the next block, for example, then what will happen? There will be some difference between the values which are present in this particular block and this particular block. And this difference we require to calculate, and then we have to convert it into the block transformation. Why? Because until and up till we are not able to do it, we are not able to do the H26.1 encoding also. Why? Because H26.1 encoding can only done on the part which is in the motion. So the still part, that means fixed part, we does not require to encode with the help of this particular algorithm. What we require to encode? The motion part. So now for this particular step or the present time, that motion occurred at this moment. That means this picture block is going to transfer from this position to this position. And that particular difference only we can see here, only this particular part which is comes under a same block or the same space. So that we try to take first and second. Still, they are not having the exact same pixel values. Why? Because block transfer occurred in this particular step. So the difference between these two common part of the image, which is present in the motion vector as well as which is present in the reference image, we try to take this, and then we try to take the difference between them, and that difference we try to provide for the block transformation. So only that part which is going to change, that will change in what manner? In the brightness, in the blueness and redness of image, that means indirectly in the luminance and chrominance. So we require to count or calculate or classify that luminance and chrominance value. So we all are familiar with the luminance component. They are having the four blocks of 8x8 size, and CBC are having the one block of 8x8 size. And so that now the next step is same as that of the JPEG, that is, we require to perform the DCT, discrete cosine transform. We require to perform the quantization and entropy coding. And that step we have to explain now deeply. Now, the first one is prediction that can be done in the motion part. Then that difference is provided for the block transformation. From this, the steps for MPEG and JPEG are same. And after that, with the help of the output coming from the block transformation, that means what here we are able to achieve 8x8 coefficients, and on which we require to perform what? DCT, quantization and entropy coding. So actually, if I want to represent the H261 block diagram, then this is nothing but the block diagram or the explanation for working of the basic operation along with all the steps in this particular model. So we have seen now prediction. This is nothing but the prediction. Prediction means what? Try to find out the best match. Current macro ball and best match. Try to find out the best match, which will provide you the good value, which will give you the good entropy, the final step or the final answer. Now, what's the purpose? The calculation of entropy. So the maximum efficiency we require to calculate. So efficiency we can calculate with the help of entropy. So for that purpose, we require to provide the input with the help of two steps, prediction and block transformation. So for clarification of prediction, we can draw the steps up to this. After that, this is nothing but step number one. After that, block transformation is this, step number two. And quantization and entropy is this, step number three. So now we have to explain step number three in detail. So in the step number three, the steps required for the entropy encoding are: convert 2D symbols into 1D, that means two dimensional into the one dimensional, apply zigzag pattern on coefficient, use RLE for the 1D pattern. So first, what we have to do, we are getting such kind of samples of n number of matrix. Suppose the matrix is n cross n after achieving output from the step number 2. Now we are in the step number 3. So, what it means by zigzag pattern? We all are familiar with such kind of architecture, which is known as zigzag. But here, some coefficients, the pixel values are present. So, if I want to elaborate the zigzag pattern, how I am able to elaborate it? With the help of such kind of architecture or symbol. So indirectly here, if you try to understand, then we are not going to use a complete number of samples or the coefficient. We try to use only the selective number of pixel values. And why? Because in this particular whole diagram, what we can able to observe, n cross n pixels or blocks are present, but we required to only do the encoding on that particular part of image which is in motion. So to select the best match or the part of the image which is in motion, we require to use the zigzag pattern. So actually this is the step number one, that is selection of the zigzag pattern. Then we require to apply few algorithms on that particular pattern. So the algorithms known as RLE. After this we are getting some output. That output may be in the form of two dimensional. Then we require to convert into one dimensional. So here again we try to do the reduction in the size of the data with the help of multiple algorithm. So that can be Huffman coding also, or that can be any other. So here specially we will try to use the lossless type of algorithm. Why? Because already with the help of quantization we try to reduce the actual data. Now here we are not able to loss the data while transmission or while doing the encoding, because in the part of the decoding we require the maximum data as that of the input, and so that only here we require to use the lossless algorithm or technique which are known as Huffman coding or RLE. So whatever output you are getting, if it is in the two dimensional, then convert it into one dimensional and then apply RLE on the one dimensional pattern. For example, if your output is this, such kind of output if you are getting, then how can I use the RLE on this particular output? How many times ones are present? One are present three times. So what are present? One are present. How many times? Three times. After that, what are present? Zeros are present. How many times? Two times. What are present? One are present. How many times? 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. 7 times. Present value? 0. How many times? 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. 6 times. So here we are able to achieve again the compression in the size of the data, not the actual data. Why? Because after the decoding, you are getting the exact same data as that of your output or input, you can say. So if I want to decode this, 1 is present 3 times, so 1 1 1 will be the output. 0 present 2 times, 0 0 will be the output. 1 present 7 times, 1 2 3 4 5 6 7. 0 present 6 times, 1 2 3 4 5 6. So this is exactly same as that of your required message. So here, hence we are using RLE for converting the 1D pattern again. So such kind of reduction in the size of the data we can achieve. This is also one of the quantization or the compression technique, we can say. So apply all these things to the calculation of entropy. How can we calculate the entropy? The basic idea behind the calculation of entropy is to calculate the efficiency, because entropy is H, L is nothing but the average number present in your sampled output, and E is nothing but efficiency. So what we expect at the final step? Efficiency. That means what? Maximum output. And hence we are try to do this entropy calculation. Once we are getting the entropy, it is very easy to calculate efficiency. So finally, what encoder are able to do? Encoders are used to translate the rotary or linear motion into the digital signal. They are used for the monitoring or controlling the motion parameters such as speed, rate, direction, distance and position. So what is the application of this particular encoding algorithm? Calculation of speed, rate, direction, distance as well as position. When applying the encoders, selecting the optimum means minimum model, and specifying the appropriate configuration are the critical for success. So in this way, where or how can we use the H.261, our first or the basic aim is the converting a signal into the digital signal. But what kind of signal should be there? Motion signal. We can use H.261 encoder or decoder only to encode the part which is present in the motion. So this is very important thing. We are not going to do the encoding of whole picture or the whole size of the data. We try to only select the motion part of the data or of the image, and then only we will do what? The encoding. And after that, the decoding is very easy. Exactly the reverse process we required to use to decode the algorithm. That is what? This is nothing but the encoder block diagram. For decoding, you are having entropy in your hand. You required to apply different algorithm to calculate the quantization. After the getting the quantized value, you have to apply DCT on the every sample. Then you are getting some 8 cross 8 coefficient, and that are nothing but what? Frequency coefficient. Then you required to again transfer them into the blocks which contains YCBCR. Then the best match you have to predict with the reference and the motion vector. So like that you can do the part of decoding also. Exactly the reverse process you have to apply for the decoding algorithm. Especially with the help of this architecture, you are able to achieve the exact input with the help of the best prediction match. And hence H.261 is famous for the decoding algorithm. H.261 is famous for the decoding algorithm, but for the purpose, we required to use all these steps. So this is the basic theory behind the H.261, which is developed by ITU in the 1988 and which comes under the MPEG chapter. Thank you.